Have you ever wondered if reality is absolute or if it changes when you observe it? What if I told you that something as simple as measuring state of system can alter its outcome? This isn't science fiction, it's quantum mechanics. And nowhere is this mystery more profound than in wave-particle duality.
In today's episode, we uncover one of the profound and most influential discoveries in physics, the double-slit experiment. What began as an experiment on light waves in the 1800s ended up shaking the very foundation of reality. Let's step into the quantum world and find out how.
Before we dive into the quantum madness, let's start with how the world was supposed to work. For centuries, physics classified everything into two categories: waves and particles.
So waves are things like water ripples, and particles are like grains of sand, right?
Exactly. Waves are disturbances that travel through a medium, carrying energy without carrying matter. They spread out, interfere, and overlap. Think of ocean waves passing through a narrow gap and forming patterns. Sound waves travel through air by compressing and expanding particles, creating pressure variations that we hear as sound. Light waves, on the other hand, can travel through empty space, oscillating as electromagnetic fields. Waves also exhibit a fascinating property called interference. When two waves meet, their peaks and troughs can either amplify each other, forming constructive interference, or cancel each other out, leading to destructive interference. This behavior is key to understanding the double-slit experiment, where light and even particles like electrons behave in ways that defy classical intuition. Particles, on the other hand, are discrete objects. They have a definite position and move in well-defined paths following Newton's laws of motion. Think of a baseball flying through the air. It follows a predictable trajectory based on its initial velocity and the forces acting upon it. Unlike waves, particles do not spread out or overlap. They exist as singular entities at specific locations.
And for the longest time, scientists thought these were completely separate things, I suppose.
That's right. It was Newton versus Huygens. Newton championed light as particles, while Huygens argued for light as waves. By the early 1800s, Thomas Young provided strong evidence in the debate with his famous double-slit experiment. Or at least, that's what we thought. In 1801, Thomas Young devised a simple but brilliant experiment. Imagine you have a handful of baseballs and two narrow slits in a wall. If you throw the baseballs at the slits, each should go through one slit or the other, landing in two neat piles on the other side. Simple, right? Now, imagine instead that you drop two pebbles into a pond at the same time. The ripples spread outward and overlap, creating a pattern of peaks and troughs. This is interference, a signature of wave behavior.
So if light was just a stream of particles, it should behave predictably with two bright spots where the light passed through the slits. So what was the verdict?
Thomas Young, an English scientist, designed an experiment to settle the debate about the nature of light. He set up a barrier with two narrow slits and a screen behind it. Then he shined light through the slits, expecting to determine whether light behaved as particles or waves. If light were made of particles, we should see two distinct bands where the light passed through the slits. But instead, Young saw something completely different, an interference pattern, just like waves. The light was spreading out and interfering with itself, forming alternating bright and dark regions on the screen. The bright areas corresponded to where the waves reinforced each other, called constructive interference, while the dark areas appeared where waves canceled each other out, called destructive interference. This pattern could only mean one thing. Light was not made of tiny particles traveling in straight lines, but instead behaved like a wave, spreading out and interacting with itself in a way that defied classical intuition.
So this proved that light was a wave?
That's what scientists thought for over 100 years. Young's experiment seemed to prove beyond doubt that light was a wave. No one questioned it. At the time, many scientists believed light waves needed a medium to travel through called the luminiferous aether. This idea persisted for decades until the Michelson-Morley experiment in 1887 found no evidence of such a medium. This unexpected result set the stage for Einstein's theory of relativity, proving that light needed no medium at all. But the real shock came when physicists decided to revisit Young's experiment, not with light, but with electrons. In the 20th century, scientists decided to fire individual electrons through the slits. Since electrons are particles, they expected to see two distinct spots on the screen. But when they checked the results, they found something shocking.
Let me guess, they saw an interference pattern, just like waves.
Exactly. This was baffling because all our earlier experiments had confirmed that electrons behaved as particles. When we measured them in other experiments, they landed in precise locations, had well-defined momenta, and obeyed Newtonian mechanics. But here, they were behaving as if they were waves, spreading out and interfering with themselves. This is similar to the nature of light itself. For centuries, scientists debated whether light was a wave or a particle. Now, electrons, previously thought of as particles, were behaving like waves. This led to a shocking realization. Perhaps everything at the quantum scale exhibited both particle and wave behavior, depending on how we observed it.
But that makes no sense. How can a single electron go through both slits? Can't we just place some kind of camera or detector at the slits to see which path the electron takes?
That's what scientists did. The electron seemed to exist in multiple paths simultaneously until we decided to observe it. That's where things get even stranger. When scientists placed a detector at the slits to see which path the electron took, the interference pattern vanished. The electron behaved like a normal particle again. This baffled physicists. Why would merely observing the electron force it to choose a single path? This sparked a heated debate about the very nature of reality. Physicists like Niels Bohr and Werner Heisenberg argued that measurement itself alters the quantum state, a key idea in the Copenhagen interpretation. This means that an interaction with any measuring device, not necessarily a conscious observer, determines the outcome. Meanwhile, Albert Einstein famously pushed back, believing that quantum mechanics was incomplete, famously stating, "God does not play dice with the universe." This experiment led to groundbreaking discussions on quantum measurement, probability, and the idea that particles do not have definite properties until measured. It paved the way for concepts like quantum entanglement and the many worlds interpretation, where every possible outcome exists in parallel realities.
But what does this mean? Did the electron know it was being watched? And if so, does reality itself depend on observation? How can just looking at something change its behavior? Sounds like that's what my dog would do, but not the electrons.
These questions remain at the heart of quantum mechanics, and we still don't have all the answers. Before we measure an electron, it behaves as if it's in multiple places at once, existing in a strange state of probability. But the moment we observe it, it chooses a single position. This is called the observer effect, and it suggests that at the quantum level, reality is not fixed until it is measured. Variations of classic double-slit experiments have shown that even future observations can retroactively determine whether an electron behaved like a wave or a particle. In the 1999 quantum eraser experiment by Yoon-Ho Kim and others, scientists used entangled photons in a delayed choice setup. The decision to measure one photon's path affected its entangled twin, even after it had already passed through the slits. How exactly this happens is still a mystery, but in the coming episodes, we'll dive deeper into quantum superposition and Schrödinger's famous thought experiment to illustrate this paradox.
So what does this mean for the real world? If an electron can be in two places at once, what about bigger things like entire objects or even people?
That's a natural question. Quantum effects usually stay at the atomic level. But experiments have shown that even large molecules can exhibit wave-like behavior. Double-slit experiments with C60 fullerenes, buckyballs, which are soccer ball-shaped molecules consisting of 60 carbon atoms, still produced an interference pattern, proving that wave-particle duality persists even at relatively large scales. More recently, researchers have extended these experiments to organic molecules containing up to 2,000 atoms. These massive molecules also displayed wave-like properties under highly controlled conditions, suggesting that quantum effects might persist far beyond the atomic scale. This raises an even bigger question. If electrons and large molecules can behave as both waves and particles, does this apply to everything? What about objects in our daily lives? Cars, tennis balls, or even humans? Theoretically, everything has a wavelength, as described by de Broglie's equation, which relates an object's wavelength to its momentum. However, for larger objects, the wavelengths become so incredibly tiny that any wave-like behavior is undetectable. A tennis ball, for example, has a wavelength so small that it is completely negligible, meaning we only observe it as a particle. This happens because macroscopic objects interact with their environment constantly, causing a process called decoherence, which destroys quantum superpositions. Unlike isolated quantum particles, larger objects are constantly measured by their surroundings — air molecules, photons, thermal vibrations — forcing them into a definite state and preventing interference effects. So, while everything technically has a wave nature, quantum effects become invisible at larger scales, keeping the classical world intact.
Has wave-particle duality been tapped for any practical applications?
Of for sure, wave-particle duality is already shaping the world around us. One of the best examples is electron microscopy. Since electrons exhibit wave behavior, we can use electron diffraction to image objects at an atomic scale, allowing us to see details far smaller than traditional light-based microscopes. Then there's quantum computing, which relies on superposition and wave-like probability distributions to perform calculations far beyond the reach of classical computers. Another key application is interferometry and precision measurement, used in projects like LIGO, which detects gravitational waves, ripples in space-time itself by exploiting wave interference. In the realm of material science, wave-based nanotechnology is unlocking new ways to manipulate matter, using quantum wave properties to engineer revolutionary materials at the smallest scales.
Wow, this is a lot to think through. So where are we headed next?
Imagine you're holding your phone right now. You know exactly where it is, right? But at the quantum level, knowing the exact position of an object means you cannot know where it is going. And the more accurately you measure its motion, the fuzzier its location becomes. This is the Heisenberg uncertainty principle. In the next episode, we will discuss why there is a fundamental limit to how much we can ever know about the world. See you soon.